In this video, I'm revisiting a composition that I treated some months ago, shortly after learning of my appointment to the podium of my university's premier contemporary chamber music ensemble. I'm remaking this video for a couple of reasons. One is that on my first pass through the project, I defaulted to a recording that I find quite unsatisfactory. At the time, I did not know that the much finer recording made by Pierre Boulez and members of the Cleveland Orchestra would be available for my use without infringement of copyright and the bringing down of a strike on my channel. Now I do know that to be the case, so it is a pleasure to present this work in a much more representative and engaging reading. The other reason is that I want to present a gift to the intrepid musicians of the University of Oklahoma who have agreed to collaborate with me in the presentation of this wonderful, quirky music. I want to address my remaining remarks to those musicians. My friends, I know of no better way to experience music than with both eyes and ears engaged in that music. Not so much in the music making, which is what our eyes feast on when we attend a concert, but the musical conception itself as represented by the published score of the composition. To have both score and sound simultaneously is to open a door directly into the composer's mind. When one can have it, that is an overwhelming aesthetic experience, and it is to that end that I have mostly dedicated my YouTube channel for the past decade. As I tell my students at every opportunity, one of the most productive ways to use the gift I'm about to give you is to approach it as though you were looking at a painting. As you follow the score, let both your eye and your mind's eye range over it in musical time, observing the rise and fall of musical lines, the jagged relations of counterpoint, the way contrary motion opens out musical spaces between high and low, the way the population density of the ensemble at any given time colors the musical painting and gives it a palpable texture. Let your eye lead your ear, and your ear lead your eye to discoveries that you almost certainly would not have made without having both senses fully engaged. Do this many times, and for the pure joy that's in it. I often liken my experience when doing this to that of my cats when bewitched by the dancing red dot from my laser pointer. I'm not demeaning the experience we have by making that comparison. I'm celebrating it. I maintain that it is impossible to give any music an accurate and respectful reading if we don't know the job description of every note, and to get there involves an exploration of that music in terms of its musical grammar and syntax, by which I mean the way musical phrases work and the way they're combined into meaningful structures that have something strikingly close to semantic meaning. That is why I indulge the kind of analysis that you see in what I've presented here. I've mostly abstained from harmonic analysis, as that's pretty hard to express meaningfully in real time in the music of a composer who wasn't particularly tied to common practice. And my parsing of this music structurally is certainly open to question. This represents my best understanding of it at the moment, but I don't for a moment imagine that better ways of understanding it are impossible or out of reach. The important thing is to have a defensible conception of the way the music works. If you have that, you'll never be guilty of merely playing notes. You'll have something to say, and you'll be saying it. If we're completely honest with ourselves, we know that we've made the greatest musical progress of our lives when we've imitated other, better, more experienced musicians, made their way of thinking about music our own, and then brought our own creative imagination to it. It is possible to play or sing in such a way that every note becomes a life metaphor, with a beginning either out of nothing or emerging from prior notes in the line, by doing whatever it does while present, waxing, waning, shouting, weeping, before yielding to the next note in the line or passing into a silence so profound that it can never be experienced. If you can do that with your playing and singing, you will be able to say the important things that you have to say, because you'll have cultivated the tools to say them. To that end, I commend the beautiful playing of the members of the Cleveland Orchestra. don't hesitate to imitate them with the expectation that I'll be asking you to do some things differently, for I do not in every respect line up with Maestro Boulez's understanding of certain passages and even of whole movements, the third and eighth in particular. I'd like to share with you some of the remarks with which I introduced this composition during my earlier treatment of it. I believe this will contribute something to your understanding of this wonderful music. Art is the truest thing there is because its only possible source is the lived experience of human beings, and it must reflect that experience and in fact cannot do otherwise. The reason the music of the 20th century sounds so radically different from that of the 19th is that that's how different those two centuries were from each other in every other respect. The piece at hand is an excellent example, music that reflects the personal and financial insecurities of its creator in a time of war, music that invokes the familiar and deconstructs it mercilessly, marches that limp and stagger as if wounded or drunk, dances that reel and wobble and grope for the beat and falter, a Lutheran chorale with the voice leading gone all wrong, the swaggering triumph of embodied evil. Stravinsky laughs throughout, but at whom? Written in 1918, when the composer was living in non-aligned Switzerland, L'Histoire du Soldat embodies the neuroses of a world at war, a world of great promise and grave danger, a time of crumbling empires and social structures, and the rise of something new slouching toward Bethlehem. The composition can be understood as an anti-war tract, but in those terms it certainly does not rise to the towering heights of Picasso's Guernica or William Butler Yeats's Second Coming, of Joseph Heller's Catch-22, or George Crumb's Black Angels. It might better be understood as a solitary artist's discontents given voice by a small ensemble whose timbres clash instead of blending, or perhaps a musical portrait of a world teetering on the lip of the abyss. Stravinsky wrote this score largely as a response to straitened financial circumstances. Despite his successes with the Ballet Russe in Paris over the preceding decade, he found himself isolated from both the French capital and the land of his birth, cut off from his royalty stream, and sinking into penury. These grim financial realities were the impetus for the creation of a theater piece using only a handful of performers who could therefore tour on a small budget and perhaps earn the composer some money. The premiere of the work was funded by a wealthy patron, but the tour bookings were all canceled owing to the 1918 Spanish flu pandemic. These circumstances, Europe engulfed in war, a deadly pandemic sweeping over the planet, whole continents teetering on the brink of financial collapse, seem as familiar a century later. What better time to take it to the concert stage than right now? The Soldier's Tale is a Faustian one, an ill-advised deal with the devil. It was, of course, originally conceived as a theater piece and is sometimes performed that way, but it's more often the case that its brilliant, quirky music finds its way to the concert stage as a suite of 9 movements. That is the version I present here in a recording by Pierre Boulez and the Cleveland Orchestra, featuring the spellbinding playing of William Prussell. The 9 sections are The Soldier's March, The Soldier at the Brook, A Pastoral, A Royal March, A Little Concert, 3 Dances, The Devil's Dance, The Grand Chorale, and The Triumphal March of the Devil. The music is sometimes tonal or nearly so, more often pan-diatonic with its clashing wrong notes, and occasionally bitonal or octatonic. The rhythmic profile is frequently one of staggering complexity. Fasten your seatbelt, keep your head and hands inside the car at all times, and enjoy the ride. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.